So, for those of you that don't know who I am Jamelian, and I am here with Esteban Martinez, who is the director and editor of the new FGC documentary, FGC. Well, wow.
Rise of the Fighting Game Community.
How are you today? I know I already asked you that question, but...
I'm still good. I saw Star Wars for the third time today. It was awesome.
Now, for the third time? Yeah, you left out that piece of information earlier.
This time I saw it in IMAX. That was an interesting experience, but it's good. It's good. Good times all around.
All right. Now, I know that your film has just come out on Tuesday, if I am correct. How's it been doing so far?
It's been doing well, both financially and feedback-wise, all good things. So I'm pretty happy with it. You work on these things in a vacuum and you're not sure how they're going to do when you put it out, but to see, you know, to not have everybody just bum rush being like, God damn, you're charging for this. This is terrible. This is awful. It's been pretty, pretty good.
That's good. That's really good to hear. Now I know that we had spoken a little bit about this earlier, but that
in fact, 30 minutes earlier,
30 minutes earlier. Yes. Yes, we did. But, that's funny. There have been some people that they have been complaining that they want to watch the documentary, but they can't pay for it right now. Are there any plans in the future to, say, try to get it on a streaming service like Netflix or Hulu or Amazon? Or are you planning on selling any hard copies or getting it to any events?
So for Netflix and Hulu, that's kind of like a legal nightmare that I would like to avoid for as much as possible. Hard copies they may be in the cards. I know a lot of people have been asking for it, but I have to take care of the Kickstarter people first. That was a Kickstarter reward, so I have to get them their copies first before I can even think about giving those out, putting those up for sale. I will say that a couple of events have approached me to show it at their events, so... we're still finalizing that kind of stuff, but that will probably be an option. And there are other options, like I'm still finalizing stuff in my head, but if you can't afford it now, do not be too surprised if, you know, later on in the future, you'll have a chance to watch it. I did not forget about you guys, but there'll be opportunities. So you might have to wait a little bit, but it's coming. Just there are bigger plans in place.
Good. I think that's good. As I told Esteban earlier, I did watch his documentary, and in the middle of it, I immediately texted my mom, and I am trying very hard to get them to watch it so that they understand a little bit more about, you know, the community that I'm a part of. It's a great film, and it definitely gives you great insight into how we got to pretty much where we're at now. But before we go more into the actual film itself, I wanted to let the viewers get to know Esteban a little bit more. So what was the first fighting game that you ever played? When did you start? And what inspired you to want to become a part of the fighting game community?
First fighting game I ever played was Street Fighter II on the Super Nintendo. And it kind of blew my mind. I'd never played a game like that. So, like, it was like a weird kind of, like, 2 months of, like, I had discovered Final Fantasy VI, and that blew my mind. And then I discovered Street Fighter II, and that, like, really blew my mind. And I was like, oh, wow, video games can be this. So I started playing Street Fighter II with my cousin. I don't know if I ever won a game. But then I started going to the arcades. Like, I grew up in Brooklyn. There were Street Fighter II machines on, like, every corner. Every pizza shop, every grocery store had a Street Fighter II machine. So it was pretty commonplace to just kind of play games like that. So, you know, drop a couple quarters in, win, lose, kind of move on. But that aspect of fighting games, the aspect of, like, the one-on-one competition where you weren't getting that with other games, really, really, I got hooked. And I've been hooked on ever since. So that's kind of what drew me into the scene, was just that one-on-one nature of fighting games. Where, like, I really want to beat this guy, or I don't want to lose to this guy, or I just want to see how far I could go. And that's what got me in.
Now, I know that one of the games that you do play and you compete in is Vampire Savior, which I know that at NEC, had just this past NEC 16 had gotten great numbers that you don't normally see for classic games like that that aren't as popular as say Street Fighter. How many people did Vampire Savior get?
We had 45.
Wow, that is a surprisingly large number for that. Do you think that we're going to see that game more at events, at least on the East Coast, or
that's a weird one because like there are certain pockets of where VSAT players are. I think like Ohio is a big one. The East Coast over here is pretty big. So like NEC is usually a larger tournament than most. Final Round is a pretty big tournament. Combo Breaker, I think, was formerly at UFGT, was also a big one. And I think Power Up was the other big one. But that I don't think that exists anymore. I don't know. Eric Big E just kind of popped into our little VSAV home Facebook page group, and he's like, you know, if you guys can get 60, there might be a pop bonus. If you get 100, it might be a bigger pop bonus in stream time. So I know I want to see it. I think that is one of the best fighting games Capcom's ever produced. It's fun. It's flexible. You can play it how you want. It's aggressive. It's fast. If you've never played it and you're playing it for the first time, don't be too surprised if you lose in 15 seconds. Like, it's just a crazy game. But I don't know. I know I have plans this year to try to get more people into it. It is an older game, so like I try to teach my friends how to play it, and they're like, wow, this looks like it was made in 1998. I'm like, because it probably was. I actually don't know the exact year, but
no, the harder games, they are a little bit, not the harder games. They
I mean, they are harder.
They are. No, but the older games, they are a little bit more difficult to get the larger community into, unless you've already played the game before and, you know, it kind of hits home to you. So I definitely know where you're coming from with that.
Actually, VSAV was a game that I didn't pick up till 2 years ago.
Really?
My friend was really big into it, Sean Hangshua, which is a GBR sign. He was really big into it. Like he would play like random select and beat my ass with every character. And I was like, huh, okay. And so I started playing it, and then I got decent where I could kind of keep up with him. And now I'm placing like top eights, which, you know, top eight, 45 people is pretty cool.
It's definitely.
It's not always 45 people. Sometimes it's 15, and it's like, well, I won two games and made top eight. Woo. But it's a fun game to play, and I see a lot of similarities in Street Fighter V with it. So I'm probably going to stick with it.
Who is your similarities with Street Fighter V? You did not bring that up before in the whole half hour we had this interview. Tell me more about that. What similarities do you see in Street Fighter V vs. Vampire Savior?
So they don't have in terms of like mechanics, they're not the same. Like Vampire Savior is based off a chain combo system similar to like the Marvel series, and it has like it has way faster mobility than most Capcom games. In fact, probably all of them. I would probably say it's a faster game than some of the Versus series games too. But in terms of how that game is like the gameplay of the game is like you're pressuring your opponent on wake up, you're falling him on wake up, you're not letting them escape. Or at least that's how I play it. So in Street Fighter V, like I see that like because you can't focus attack, because you can't backdash, because backdash is no longer invincible, you have to deal with that pressure game. So like if somebody gets a knockdown and dashes twice up to it and starts pressing with medium punches and stuff like that, you have to either take a risk and hope it pays off or block. And that's kind of the stuff that you have to deal with in Vampire Savior, where it's like, you know, you got to deal with two frame command grabs and like attacks that can hit you in really crazy positions. Like Talbane can do a beast cannon over you and then directly down on you, and you have to guess whether that's left or right. And it could be like a pixel off and it'd be left, a pixel off be right. Like you have to kind of deal with that kind of pressure. And while Street Fighter V won't have that, which is almost borderline insane kind of pressure, you're still going to have to make decisions when your opponent is right in front of you, which is not something you saw a lot in Street Fighter IV. In Street Fighter IV, you saw a lot of kind of ambiguous, like really kind of like, I don't know how to describe it, but it was like, it was a lot of mix-ups that took advantage of the system. Whereas, it's more player oriented in five, it seems like. I don't know if that makes sense, but like somebody's gonna push somebody's gonna like stand in your face and push buttons instead of like jumping up at an odd angle and trying to mix you up.
You mean like mashing?
Not exactly mashing, like because mashing seems like it won't do you that well in this game.
Jabs in Street Fighter 5, no.
Yeah, jabs won't lead.
No, I don't anticipate that it will.
Yeah, so like jabs don't lead. Jabs are more of an interrupt or a defensive option than they are like a combo starter like they were in 4. So like you'll get mashes and maybe you'll get out of stuff or maybe you'll just get blown up. Like that's going to be the game. And I am very excited for it.
Street Fighter 5.
Yep.
Now, you have the beta, right?
It's kind of like we did this already.
Oh, you know what? It seems so familiar to me. But, you know what? Okay. No, as you said to me earlier, you do have the Street Fighter V beta. Tell us again what your views are on Street Fighter V so far and who you're thinking about maining.
So like I said a couple minutes ago, it's a rushdown game. It wants to be a rushdown game, but it's kind of a controlled rushdown game where it's like you got to win this neutral game first, and then once you get the knockdown, you just want to maul your opponent. At least that's what it looks like from the first beta. It's like there weren't that many great players online for the first 3 beta periods where it's like I played a lot of people where I literally just stood in front of their face and they'd like crouching medium punch and like they were hit 90% of the time. Mostly because they were either trying to hit me back or they were trying to jump. But it's going to be a game where it's like, it's going to be how many resources and how many options do you really have? And what happens when they're exhausted? What happens when your opponent is blocking everything? Are you going to crack? Are you going to be able to be consistent? Like, it's going to be a game that rewards consistency. So I'm really excited about that. Like, it's very simple. Like, there's a small cast of characters to start with, only 16. They have a small amount of moves. There's not that many defensive options. Like, you have block, you have throw, tech. You have a quick get up and a quick, like, I think, like a little small little rollback. So you don't have to worry that much about, you know, what your opponent's going to do on wake up or you know the rules of the game, at least to start. But it's going to be an explosive game. It's going to be a game of getting that knockdown, getting in front of your opponent's face, and just trying to break them, not just as the character, but as the player. Like, it's going to be a lot more mental.
So you believe that Street Fighter V is going to be bigger than Street Fighter 4 was as a whole?
I think it's going to so – that's the one thing I'm scared about is I think it's going to be huge. Like, you have Sony backing it. There's a lot of attention on it. You know, as long as online, because online like hasn't been consistent in the beta period, so that's a fear that I have, where like day one comes out and nobody can play online or nobody can play online reliably. But the thing I worry about is that there's going to be a lot more players playing. I hope they stick around, because this is going to be a game that's going to punish you. Like, it's like in one of the interviews with Seth that I did, he talked about how Street Fighter isn't really like a. It's not a. It's like most games are like a power fantasy. Like, you play a powerful character and you go through a world and you kind of like you're in charge. Whereas fighting games are kind of like a disempowerment, where it's like you pick up a game and somebody just beats you and it's just like what just happened. And I feel like that's gonna happen a lot more in 5, or especially with older players that are coming out to play, that have played games like Alpha 2 or ST, and they have that mentality of like. Yeah, we know how to play this. Like, good luck. I hope people stick with it. And my job as a content creator is to kind of keep people with it. And I know other people feel the same way. So.
And I know that you were talking about the content that you're hoping to create, though, isn't going to focus so much in 2016, though, necessarily on games like Street Fighter V. You actually want to focus on the games that are getting least amount of attention, right? To try to showcase them and get them out there more.
Yeah. So I'm definitely going to do stuff on Street Fighter V, but I also want to look at other communities. Like that was kind of like the if I can say there was like one complaint about the film was that I didn't get to focus on other stuff like MK and KI as much as I wanted to. But for what I was attempting to do with the film, like, The film is basically it's a love letter to fighting games and the community, but it's also made for newer people who have never heard of fighting games or the community. So like when people go, well, why is an MK or NRS in this? For the non gaming or the non fighting game user, they may not even understand the difference. So there was that part. There was also technical limitations, like I said before, where like I think I know one person with an Xbox One and Killer Instinct, and I just couldn't get to them. Like, I recorded, like, my TV's back there, my PS4's down there, as well as an Xbox. Like, that's where all the game footage got recorded, and my PC. And I did all that myself. So it's like, you know, technical limitations limit me to what games I could have put in. But for the channel, for this year, for the channel, it's like, I want to do more for every scene, whether that is interviewing one person from every scene at every event, regardless of, like, position, because I think that's important. Like, I'll just interview people I like, or I think are cool or have an interesting story, regardless on if they place high or if they, you know, have, you know, they do well in tournament. And to do that, as well as to focus on older games, because I think as we get newer players in, we're kind of losing the historical perspective of fighting games. Like, we're losing, you know, some people might not know what Vampire Savior, some people might not know what an RC is in CBS2, some people might not know about these older games, or like the differences between Super Turbo and Hyper Fighting. Like, people might not know that, and I want to kind of educate them in that way. So I want to do a lot of focuses on older content, like older games, their communities, their stories, as well as the upcoming Street Fighter V, and you know, not just Street Fighter V, anime, Mortal Kombat, KI, and everything that's out there.
And I think that that's great, because I think that's something that's really important, especially with ESPN now starting their own ESPN esports.
A lot to say on that, but I'm still...
Do you? All right, yeah. You know what? Then I will make that a point before the end of this interview to bring that back up.
I don't have all those thoughts solidified yet.
No? Okay.
Not yet, but there's that
I have thoughts. I was planning on making a video about it, actually, in the future.
Like,
but
oh, by the way, we're in esports now. It's like, all right, sure. And then we can get into a whole conversation about, like, what is esports, like, in terms of, like, the term. But
you know,
it's
what?
Interesting.
It's not a bad thing.
It's just interesting.
You know what? I'm absolutely sure that we could get into a very long discussion about the FGC and esports and the kind of effect that ESPN has on something like that. Very briefly, I do think that it's a good thing that we have ESPN's backing. I think it's a huge stride that we made. I have some concerns, more so for the FGC than I do about ESPN actually supporting us. And that has a lot to do with change and what type of changes are going to be made. Obviously, the more money and support we get, the more that's going to help us grow, and that's great. But I worry a little bit more about whether or not it's going to be done correctly, and who is going to decide that it's their job to take over. I don't know if that makes sense or not, but that's more my concern with taking away the essence of what the FGC is when more money gets involved.
Right.
But I encourage ESPN and other organizations to support it and, you know, help showcase it. I think that that's a really important thing. But I do know that a lot of players are concerned, obviously, about the same thing I just mentioned, taking away from what the FGC is. But, yeah, I don't know if you agree on that or if...
I think we'll be fine. I'm not entirely convinced that ESPN and larger outlets are actually interested in the fighting game community, as could be seen from when they launched their events calendar and there were no FGC events or Smash events.
Yeah, I'm trying. You know what? I know they added some FGC and some Smash, and I have been reaching out to them trying to get a hold of them, but they're not very...
Yeah, that's Disney. Like, that's...
I'm trying, like, persistently every single day, like, hey, you're missing a ton of our events. There's not just like three, like
Right.
there's a lot more. Like, if you're gonna actually claim that you're gonna support the FGC and the Smash community, all fighting game, well then there's a lot more and a lot larger, bigger ones than the ones that, I mean,
Yeah.
obviously they have some majors. They did include KIT and they put Final Round on there, but like that was that they that
Yeah.
then like one in France, and I was like, well, we've won next month, right after Street Fighter V comes out. Where's Winter Brawl?
Winter Brawl is on there, and I can't remember. I know
Wait, they
there's
put Winter
others.
Brawl on there?
No, it's not. I don't know
Oh,
if it's on there.
okay.
Like literally, there's a major in like a month, like, and it was not there. But.
Yeah. But getting off that topic, 'cause I could stay on that for a while.
Yeah, trust me, I can too.
Let's talk about your film.
Yes.
FGC, Rise of the Fighting Game Community. What was your inspiration for making the film? And what were you hoping to accomplish with it?
So the inspirations are just the fighting games themselves, like just the community. Like I've been a part of it for a couple of years now, and like I just love the people. Like I not everybody, but like there are a lot of, most of the community is awesome. I like I just like the relationships I've kind of forged and the friendships I've forged being a part of it. And I was like, well, this is really cool, and I want to show the rest of the world. In terms of like actual like video inspiration, it would definitely be Ian Cofino's I Got Next. I love that movie. It's very gritty. It's very it's like it, I think if I remember the story right, it was like a school project, and it turned into like all of a sudden I'm watching on Hulu, and I was like, that's really cool. I think I could do that. And then Indie Game the Movie, which is like beautifully shot. It's a wonderful story of independent game development. And I was like, okay, so if I can just find the right subjects to make them relatable and put the community aspect around it, I think I got something here. And so, I contacted a few people. I met Joe, L.I. Joe. I met John Gallagher. I met L.K. And I was like, okay, I think these are going to be the guys that I try to, here's the community and here's the people in the community. And this is a really cool thing. So the main goal at the end of the day was just like, if I can get one person to be like, I want to try fighting games, or I want to go to Evo, or I want to go to this event, I did my job. And so far, that seems to be the case. Like, I think we launched and my friend watched it in like an hour, and he was like, I want to go to Evo next year. How do I go? I was like, cool. Like, that's exactly what I want to do. So while it is a love letter to the community and fighting games, I also want it to get out to the general public and just be like, hey, look, guys, this is what we're doing. You guys should come check it out.
Yeah, you know, one of the great things I loved about the documentary was not just, that you had everybody talking with the different shots in the beginning about what it was that made the FGC, how it was before compared to how it was now. I mean, it was great to hear about, how, they thought it was great that there was like 100 people
Yeah.
coming to an FGC event, and now we have thousands. And it's fantastic, to see that type of growth and get to hear about what it was like then, compared to now. And it's important for everybody to know where we came from. And I definitely got that from there. But not only that, is you had chosen, one player to kind of focus on, and one event to kind of focus on, to kind of, at least you can correct me if I'm wrong here, but what I took from it was that you wanted to kind of almost give an inside scoop to
Sort of
like
like.
what was behind the scenes of the event a little bit, how, say one event maybe started and what might go through a player's head.
Yeah, and that was kind of like it was weird because like I was positioning this to a newer audience, so like I could have like asked LK like, well, how do you deal with this mix-up, or like when somebody's in front of you and stuff like that, and it would have instantly like. You, the rest of the general public would just be like, what? Like, huh? Where are we going? So, like, trying to figure out how to be like, well, I know like what all this stuff is. Like, I know like when playing a game, like the mind game stuff like that. But how do I show this in a digestible way for a newer audience? And so I am a firm believer that if you are able to make somebody relatable and to tell a good story, that stuff will kind of just come through as osmosis. Like, people will just kind of pick on it. And from what I, like, one of the I sent out a bunch of test copies at one point. Just, you know, I had a bunch of people and I was like, look, I just want you guys to watch it. Let me know what you think so I can go back in the editing process. And a lot of the people that I sent it to were women who didn't play games or who played games and didn't know about fighting games. And I did that because it's like, if they can follow this and if they can understand this, like, we're good. Like, this is the audience I'm trying to hit. And if they feel represented, which, you know, I could have done a better job. We had Persia in there. And we had a lot of there's a lot of shots of women playing games because, you know, it is kind of a, there are not a lot of women in the scene, but it's getting better.
It's definitely an issue. Yeah. But it's an issue that's improving, and I just think it just needs a little bit more time. I know, me personally, one thing that I'm trying very hard to focus on is, you know, and some people might not agree with me on this, is I don't really put emphasis on the fact that I'm a girl. I don't feel like I need to do that. The point is, I enjoy video games. I love fighting games. I want to help the community grow. I want to be a part of it and keep attending events and do more. And that's what I intend to do. The stereotype and what's put out there is that in order for a female to be successful, she needs to flaunt the fact that she's a female. And so they feel the need to dress up in a certain way, to act a certain way. And that's not all of them. It's only some of them. And then there's others who don't want to appear that way, but then they get harassed for not being that way. And there's a lot of complicating sides of it. I've definitely seen females who feel the need to act that way in order to get, you know, acceptance. And then I've seen other females who don't want to conform to those, you know, those stereotypes, and in response they get very harassed. I mean, pretty much either way you get harassed, but for them, they'll get harassed because they're not acting that way, and then they don't want to be a part of the scene or the community anymore because they're not getting the support that, you know, they want. So I think one way to help that is just ignore the haters, focus on, you know, positivity, but letting females know that, you know, yeah, it is complicated. Letting females know they shouldn't be afraid, right, is basically where I was going to go with that.
And they're not, women aren't represented that well in gaming. So like when I sent this film out to them, and I got an overwhelming positive response, and I was like, okay, so I know it's hitting everywhere, and all I have to do is just make sure that I don't screw up the launch and everything's good and we should be good. And from what I'm seeing is like it's hitting a good demographic of people. And people are getting it, people are understanding it, people are enjoying it. And while it might not be the most technically complicated film out there, like we don't go into like the greater aspect of fighting games, it's what I want it to do. It's just to bring more people into the scene. And so far it's doing its job.
You know what? I think the thing to remember is that for your very first documentary, you did an amazing job, Esteban. I mean, I thoroughly enjoyed watching every second of it. And I'm not just saying that. Like, I honestly did. Otherwise, I wouldn't have been messaging other people saying, yo, watch this. Because right. I wanted them to see, look, this is, you know, what I'm talking about. And if I have to keep showing them documentaries and videos to try to help them, then that's what I'm going to do. And your video has now just been added to the list of videos that I can now encourage people to watch so that they can learn more about what it's like. And I think what's great, too, is John Gallagher was talking in the documentary about working in a job and the amount of time it takes. And that is true. I work a 40-hour a week job, and then I come home and I work on more stuff in the FGC. You need to have a job outside of it, and people don't realize that, you know. And I think that that's another stereotype that is very difficult for the gaming scene as a whole, in society, is we all don't have jobs. We sit around all day in our parents' basement and we play video games. No, we don't.
I wish I could.
I know, right?
I would love that life.
I would have so much money. I wouldn't have to pay bills all the time. But no, I mean, I think it's important for people to realize how much actual work and dedication goes into this. And I think that that showcases, you know, in the film. And I think that that's what you were trying to get across as well.
Yeah, and to put that perspective, even working on the film was like that. So when we kickstarted this, I was like in between jobs. That's like, cool, I'm going to be able to kind of do this. I'll have a lot more time. Like, I'm working part-time at a web development agency. I'll be able to make a film. It'll be great. We got funded that week. Afterwards, I got hired at a very popular sports team in Philadelphia that may play football. And
can I say who it is?
I mean, you can.
You don't want to say it.
I mean, I used to work at Philadelphia Eagles. Like, okay, see
that there. There you go.
It's a
good accomplishment.
So I used to work there, but at the same time, all that free time that I was going to have to make this film went away. Like, that's a very high demanding job. I'd have to work, you know, very late nights. I have to work weekends, stuff like that. So it would be like, I would go to the event. Like, CEO is a big one. Like, CEO, when I went to film there, I would get there on Thursday night, Friday night. I would film Friday, Saturday, Sunday. And I remember the event ended, and I was editing on a couch right outside the venue hall, waiting for my taxi to pick me up, to take me to the airport, to get on the plane, to go back to work. So it was a lot of that. So I was doing this film for 2 years where I was working nights and weekends on top of that, on top of the job. And if I didn't have the job, I wouldn't be able to do the film. Like we kickstarted that money, but that was just for the film. Like, I still had to live. Like, I still had to, you know, pay bills and stuff like that. So, like, even in the film that's represented, where, like, putting that together was tough. It was hard. But I'm very happy with how it came out.
Of course. Now, how long did it take you to make the film from the time that you knew you wanted to do it and the Kickstarter happened to now?
So the original pitch for the film was formed 2 or 3 years ago, like before the film actually ever hit Kickstarter. It was something I was going to do with two friends, but things fell through and I kind of left it on the shelf. And then when I was in between jobs, I was like, okay. My work with Hold Back to Block, like the videos I'm putting up Hold Back to Block, are getting better. They're getting competent. I'm understanding the aspects of production and how to shoot and what I want to shoot. And I have a camera that I could finally do. Like, I upgraded my camera at that time. And I was like, okay, so do we do this and what goes into it? So that's when I learned how to put a budget together. Original budget for the film was $25,000. And then I was like, I'll Kickstarter it because that's a cool idea. Like, that's what all the kids are doing. And I went on Kickstarter, I typed FGC in, and I saw like five different documentaries that got funded and never came out. And I was like, that sucks.
That can be a little, you know, a little nerve-wracking when you decide you're going to do it.
Especially for like for the amount of money I want to do, which is like, that's like $25,000 is like, I don't want to say it's minimum, but like for like, you know, getting the equipment, traveling to events, post-production, like that's around like kind of like the amount you want to do it, especially for your first film.
Right, and the thing about films for people to remember is that if you want to make a good quality video in general, not only does it need quality equipment, which, believe me, costs a lot of money, it needs quality everything and time and money.
Money and time, things you need.
A lot of money. So I mean, I definitely understand that struggle.
Yeah. So like when we wanted to, I was going to launch the Kickstarter in November 2013. So I just looked at everything. I was like, you know, I'm just going to cut this budget. Like, I'm going to slash it. Like, took $15,000 off. I was like, I'm just going to try to raise 10, which is like 8. After Kickstarter and Amazon take their fees, and I'm just going to pay for the rest of myself. And I remember, I think either Pat the Flip, who did an interview with me on SRK, or Ian to the Max, one of them was like, Like they couldn't say, "Are you crazy?" Like trying to make a film for 8K like in an interview. But they're like, "Are you sure this is a great idea?" And I'm like, I couldn't say at the time where it's like, you know, I look at the community's been burned so much in terms of money and in terms of people asking for money and not delivering on promises, where it's like I need to earn the goodwill. And like I had goodwill with Hold Back the Block, but I didn't have goodwill in terms of asking for money. So I was like, I know I can do this. I know I can see this through the end. So let's just launch this November, see what happens. And we got funded December, and now we're here. I paid a decent amount of money of my own money, like my credit card. I have a credit card that's screaming right now. Like you can't hear it. That's because I've stuffed it somewhere in this apartment. But at night it just howls. And you know, that was also the prime factor for also charging for the film, because I wish I could put everything out for free, and for the most part I have, but for this project it just demanded, like, you know, this could do really well. Like even Sandbox with the Smash Bros. Documentary, it did really well. It does millions and millions in views. He was still like 6K in the hole when it came out. Like that's crazy. And the dude like quit his job to like to finish this stuff. And like, you know, you could have the most success on YouTube possible, and you could not be making as much as you think. I think with my channel, you know, I do okay, but like in terms of view wise, but I think I've seen probably $100 since I've started doing videos just off of ad revenue. Like it's not a good avenue of support.
Right.
So like something like this that demanded, like, you know, I'm going to put a ton of my own money into it. Like I have to try to make some back.
I, you know, it can be difficult. And it takes time. That's something that, you know, I've been asked before advice on how to, you know, get six, how to be successful, how to gain a lot of viewership, how to get to this point. And it takes work. It not only work and consistently producing content and being active online, definitely the active online and with social media, that is one of the biggest, you know, things that I've learned that I tell people, use social media to your advantage. And it's a learning process all around. But what people don't understand is you can put in that work as much as you want for a year, 2 years, however many it is, and barely make a single cent, you know, out of it. But you have to have that passion and that dedication to keep doing it, to eventually get yourself to the point where you might actually be making a decent amount of money where you are able to say, okay, here you go. Here's this for free. This is my gift to you.
It's hard, and it's hardly ever an overnight success. Like even people like Maximilian, like Max has been on the grind for years, and he's starting to see it. Like he's exploded in the past couple of years, but he's been a guy who's been on that grind. And Gutex is another one. Like Gutex is, he gets demonified like in the community sometimes because of the fact that he, you know, he charges for stuff. He always like runs promo deals and stuff like that. But he is a pioneer in the scene of like, oh yeah, you can do all this stuff and still make a good living out of it. And so I look at what he does a lot and I go, well, you know, if I ever got to that level of popularity, if my content ever got, because I never want to get to that level of popularity. My content should, but not me. I don't like being in front of the camera. But
I have you on spot tonight, and
I
I'm gonna
know.
upload this
Sucks.
on, you know, YouTube, despite how the beginning happened. So
It sucks so much. Like I hate being on camera. I get nervous. But
you're doing just fine to me.
thank you.
You're
But
welcome.
he gets a lot of shit for what he did. And I remember learning about the FGC through his podcast. Like he gave out like a free podcast of Street Fighter 4 talk with Ken Ma talking about Ken, and it was just the two of them talking about how do you play Ken, like how do you use crouching medium kick, how do you use his uppercuts, and it was like an hour or so, something like that. And through that, like that's how I was like, oh yeah, people do this, like not in terms of playing fighting games, but like people just like do podcasts. And first of all, what's a podcast? But like people do podcasts and videos on like this stuff, like care. And that's what got me into content creation. Like that's one of the many things I did. So it's tough. Like you can be dedicated, you could be the best, but if you can't pay your bills, it's very hard to do it. As much as you love it, as much as you want to do it for the love, like, it's hard. Like, you got to eat. And there have been times where I've had to put down the camera and go to my 9-to-5 and just, I had to focus on that instead of doing what I really want to do is fighting games, is content and fighting games. And, until you make it sustainable, it can be rough. It can be very rough.
You know, it definitely can. And that's why I like to, remind people, like, say for myself, like, when I posted my first interview, and I mean, like, my first one, I started off with written ones, and the first one for the community was CD Jr. Mm. And I felt so lucky that I even managed to get that, because honestly, nobody really knew who I was when I did that. And, I know I had one goal in mind when I did do it, and, I had 47 followers on Twitter, and that was March 2014. And I had never thought that at this point I would be where I'm at today, which is completely different than what I expected. But I'm now at like 900 and something. Mm. And that did not come from just sitting around and not punching out the work for free.
Yeah.
I approach people, and even when people approached me about if I would do an interview, I didn't charge. I didn't do anything. People were like, my parents like, oh, you need to charge. I'm like, I can't. I'm not going to do that. Like, I can't do that. That's not what I set out to do. But it can, it's lengthy. And you have to be willing to accept that and put in the work if you want to get the results that you want, which you did. Mm-hmm. It took you as long as it took you several years to make the film, but you worked, you paid your bills, you worked outside of it, and you sacrificed that time in order to do it. And that's important. And that shows. So are you planning on doing any documentaries in the future? Again?
Yes. I am figuring out what I have an idea for, like, 4 or 5 more.
Wow.
Which is crazy, because that's like 10 years of my life. But I have an idea for next one. I don't want to reveal what it is. It is going to be gaming related, not necessarily fighting game related, but doing this was fun. Like, it was hard. It was very hard, especially with the limited budget, and me staying up at night going, oh God, if this doesn't work, I am so in trouble. I like it. I love film. I love learning more about it. I'm very proud of this film. It's not perfect. There's some things like I have to learn in terms of storytelling wise, but I think it's competent. I think it's great. Otherwise, I wouldn't put it up for sale. I believe in my work and stuff like that. So I have this idea floating in my head. I'm working on it. I might ask somebody to help me with it, because I want to kind of collaborate more. That's another goal this year, is kind of collaborate more with other content creators. Definitely going to do it again. And maybe not just documentaries, maybe other stuff.
So have you thought about getting into other games outside of the FGC?
Oh, yeah, sure. Like, I love the fighting game community. I love fighting games, but I am such a big gamer. Like, I've been playing games since I can remember, and they were, like, always fighting games. Like, I love Mario. I love platformers. I recently started getting into, like, Overwatch and CSGO. I love non-competitive games. As much as I do competitive games. So,
how old are you again?
I am 27.
Do you remember floppy disks?
Yes, I played games.
Okay, no, so did I. That's why, I was asking. I wasn't sure if I was the only one here who, I mean, I kind of played on the tail end of the floppy disk era, but.
Yeah. So I used to play like Home Alone on floppy disk, and it was the worst because you had to load like 5 of them before you could even play the game. And I had I didn't have a real computer until I moved to New Jersey in like 1999. So like, I didn't have the internet till then. I didn't have any of that stuff. So I was just stuck to like Zoo Kids and Home Alone and whatever had on my NES and SNES.
No Oregon Trail?
No, I didn't play Oregon Trail until college.
Until oh wow, okay. Yeah, no, I think I gave up on Oregon Trail a long time ago.
That's an interesting game. I like it though. Like I still play it every now and then where it's like, well, I should die to dysentery again. God.
I tell people the first game I remember ever playing, and I was obsessed with it like when I was 5 or 6, and it's, I rewatched it recently, like some like gameplay videos, because they actually ended up releasing it on Steam, and I was like, all right, well, let me, check out the video and showing somebody, because I'm like, look how awesome this game. Yeah, it's not as easy at 27 to explain to somebody why it was awesome when you were like 6,
Right.
but I mean, do you remember the game Fatty Bear?
That sounds familiar. I don't think I've ever played it.
Yeah, it was about this stuffed animal bear who, when Kayla, his the girl, went to sleep, her birthday was the next day, and we had to get everything ready for
Right.
her birthday the next day. But it was enjoyable. But I mean, my point is that I get you. There's a lot of other games out there that I enjoy playing as well. It's just the one that I'm primarily enjoy, and that's fighting games.
Yeah,
But
and it's the one that like the fighting games are the game like are the games that I just want to talk about. Like those are the games like it's very it, not that it's very hard for me to get into games. Like I just played a game called Undertale, which is fantastic and everybody should play it. But like it's very few and far be in between that I want to like talk in depth on camera or make content about like the glories of platformers. Like that's not my thing. But like I could talk about like the strategy between like Daigo and Infiltration at like Evo 2012. Like I can talk about it all day. So it's just the type of game I've chosen to kind of make my stand on.
so you are you gonna completely branch off in 2016 into like CS:GO and other games like that, or are you gonna still stick with the
I'm
FGC?
so oh no like hold back the block is always going to be an FGC first channel. There may be times where I do other stuff like I experimented with League and stuff like that, mostly because I was playing those games and I was like, well, I'm playing these games, I'm okay at them, I can record this stuff and try to make it relate to like an FGC audience and stuff like that. So like it's always going to be a fighting game first channel. Whenever I'm at an event, I'm going to do interviews. I'm going to start doing podcasts and stuff like that. Like I'm going to have one going up soon with Tempest Rob or Robert Paul. You may know him as he's the photographer that's kind of blowing up everywhere. He's right now at Genesis shooting the largest melee. Well, no, I think it's just short of being the largest melee tournament. But he's out there doing now. He's an awesome dude and an okay Bison player, even though he loses to me all the time.
I do know who he is. He's a
Yeah,
nice guy.
he's great. But I'm gonna do more varied types of content. I want to do more history stuff. I want to do more podcasts. I want to do the goal is to produce more. The goal is to start content and get it out the door and just do that consistently. But on the flip side of that, I did start a Let's Play a long time ago and I never finished it, so I may finish that.
What game?
Called Lone Survivor. It's a 2D horror game, kind of psychological horror game. Based on like Silent Hill, sort of. And I didn't finish it, one, because I got busy, and two, because I got scared shitless and I was like, oh God. So I may finish that, but I also want to do like, there are a ton of games I haven't played. Like, I've never played Super Metroid. I've never played some of like the games that people think are classics. So I want to do some stuff with that too at some point.
That's great. So to start, wrapping up a little bit here. So we've heard a lot of great goals for the 2016 year. I am not 100% sure if we touched on this in this past hour or not, or if it was in the first half hour that didn't play.
Lost to the void.
Yeah, I know. I'm so sad about
It's all right.
that. But I believe you are planning on competing
Yes.
too in Street Fighter V. And I know Matt Stalin had made a comment in here, F his Karen. I guess he's not looking forward to you playing Karen in Street Fighter V.
Wait, I'm not looking forward to playing Karen.
No, Matt Stalin, he's all.
I like she is fun. Like I pick characters based on personality. Like I played Slayer in Guilty Gear, not because like he wound up being like one of the best characters in Accent Corps, but I picked him because like he was just stylish, and like when you beat him, you didn't really beat him. He just sat and looked at you and like smoked on his pipe, and I was like, that's awesome. Like that's great. And like he was the only character, or he may have been the only character at the time who didn't fight with a weapon, and he didn't have chain combos, so you had to actually work with him. I was like, I like that character in play. And Karen is one of those characters where like she's just cool, she's confident, she will beat you up and laugh at you about it. And gameplay wise, like I like the, I have three different options right now. I'm going to throw at your face, and you have to guess right. You're going to be on the ground, and I'm going to make you guess again, and like kind of mix up. And so she's like a nice mix between how I play Talbane in Vampire Savior and like Yun, who I like to play a lot and casually in Street Fighter 4. So
Mad Stalin is Ron. You know who he is.
okay.
Yeah, I thought you might know who what his Twitch tag
No,
is,
I did not know
but
that.
I guess you didn't. So, I was just letting you know that he's saying here that you beat his
Yeah,
Nash at Temple,
he's already he tried to throw some shade on me on Twitter about like I don't know, like he was like, you're excited to play Street Fighter V, and I was just like immediately like, yeah, I can't wait to beat you up with Karen, like it's gonna be awesome. And then he sent me a great V-triggered image, which I laughed really hard at. But yeah, it's fun. Like I can't wait to play that game, and I can't wait to compete. I'm not gonna say that I'm gonna try to aim for. I know LK did an interview recently with one of my friends Partis, where he was like he's aiming for Capcom Cup this year.
That's a great
And
goal.
I think he can do it. Like the way he breaks down games is kind of crazy. Like I watched him train one day and it was just like this, I've never seen anybody do this stuff before. So I think if he can stay mentally focused, I think he has a good shot. I would not sleep on him at all just because he plays anime. He's very competent in all fighting games. But as for me, I just want to play. Like if I can like just get out of pools one day, it'll be great. That's all I want. And
That's my goal too this year. I want to make it out of pools once, at least once. I don't give myself very big goals, but
Yeah, it's good to start small.
I try to give myself realistic goals and then go from there. But I always think that, even making it out of pools is a huge accomplishment. So I like to this is that's my goal this year, but too. But what event will we see you at next?
I'll be at Winter Brawl. I don't know. I think for the most part everybody's taking a break until Winter Brawl. Like I couldn't go to KIT, I couldn't go to Genesis just because I was launching the film this week, and like to do that on top of all of the what goes into launching a film,
Oh,
and
yeah.
what I'm learning because I've never done it before, so I'm glad I did not do that. But I think Winter Brawl will be the next one, and then Final Round will be there. CEO, Combo Breaker, and Evo. Those are definitely the ones I'm going to, at least confirmed for the most part. And then whatever's in between. Like I want to go to a couple more Smash events this year. I want to get to know that community more. I want to do more with that community. I really, really wanted to go to the Killer Instinct World Cup, but I don't think that's going to fit in my schedule. But lots of little events in between. Like I want to go to Next Level before it closes again. Like I definitely want to go for their last day.
Oh wait,
And
I thought they weren't closing then.
I say that, but I don't know if they're actually closing. The last I heard was that it's a possibility, but we haven't heard a confirmation that it isn't closing or it's staying open yet, or at least I
Yeah,
haven't.
I know it was like, oh, it's closing, that's it. And then they came out, they're like, no, it's not really. And then
Yeah.
that's the last I heard that it wasn't.
As
That's
far as
why.
I know, the last thing I heard is that like there's a Third Strike event coming up by the guys who run the Third Strike fighting community in New York. They're running an event. They're labeling it as the last Third Strike event in Next Level. So I don't know if they know something that we don't. But it all signs point to it's a possibility. So if it does happen, I definitely want to go out there and do something special. As well as just I want to go to MAGFest. Like I want to go to other gaming stuff this year. I'm definitely going to PAX East. I bought my tickets. I might buy tickets for MAGFest and just do other stuff too.
Great. So this is my signature question that I always love to ask. If you could be one superhero and one fighting game character, Who would it be and why?
Superhero would be Green Lantern. Like, I love Green Lantern. I think the whole mythology around the Green Lanterns are cool, but the concept of having to use will and willpower to protect other people and to fight the good fight is always a concept I've loved. So that would be the superhero part. As for fighting games, Terry Bogard from Fatal Fury is like the quintessential role model
I
of
will not lie. When you said Terry Bogard, I thought instantly of the player. It was,
Oh no, not the player.
I'm like,
But
oh, Marvel.
Terry Fatal Fury, Garou, Mark of the Wolves, King of Fighters. That was actually I used to play that game next to Street Fighter a lot. And that was the game that got me into anime because the first time I ever heard about anime was when I went into like a Suncoast city and there was a tape called Fatal Fury, Legend of the Hungry Wolf. And I was like, what is this? And I'm gonna watch it. And I was like, oh my God, this is like a cartoon based on the game I like. And then I discovered anime through that. So yeah, like Terry's dope. And if I could be somebody like that, that'd be great.
Okay, well, thank you so much for your time. Once again, to the viewers that honestly stuck it out, and I mean stuck it out for the whole hour and a half, given the first half hour, I didn't realize it wasn't streaming. I want to thank you so much. I also want to thank Esteban for your patience because I know there was some questions that you had to repeat in there and answer, and I appreciate that. And if you want to watch his new documentary about the FGC, you can go to www.fgcfilm.com. If you want to buy the film, it is $10. It
Yeah,
is, okay,
so
I want to make sure I was correct. It's $10 and you get exclusive interviews that go along with it that you can't get if you rent it. Renting it is $4. If you rent it for $4, you have 3 days
Yeah, and I believe it's
to watch
3 days
the film.
from when you start watching it.
It is 3 days from when you start watching it, which means if you watch it once, you can always go back and you can watch it again, right? Yes. Okay. Good, 'cause I was gonna go back and watch it again. So if you want to follow Esteban in the future to see what other content he's producing, you can go to twitter.com/thebesteban, facebook.com/holdbacktoblock, or twitch.tv/holdbacktoblock as
And
well.
then you can actually sub to the channel too at youtube.com/holdbacktoblock or holdbacktoblock TV. I think they both will take you to the channel.
I was going to do YouTube next, so.
Sorry, I just jumped in. I figured I'd
No,
say something.
that's okay. I can completely understand you wanting to make sure YouTube got in there. So thank you again, and thank you so much to the viewers. I will be uploading this on to YouTube tonight. That is the plan. For those that aren't able to watch it or popped in the first half hour and was like, okay, and left. So I hope you all have a good night.
Night.
And I'll be streaming again soon.